Hello everyone, today I'll be covering the summary on Ind AS 116 and the topics will have been arranged in the same manner as arranged by the ICISM. So don't worry on that. Now I'll begin the video right away. So first the overview of Ind AS 116. So what was the objective of bringing Ind AS 116 into role? So if we had an existing standard Ind AS 17 on leases, why was Ind AS 116 required? So the reason is that under Ind AS 17, the lessee did not always classify the asset in its, did not always recognize the asset in his or her balance sheet. The lessee had an option to choose either operating lease or financial lease depending on the conditions. So because of that arrangement, that the off balance sheet financing arrangement was not easily traceable through the balance sheet, through the financial statements of the lessee. So Ind AS 116, on the other hand, it made it compulsory for the lessee to recognize every lease transaction. In every lease transaction, the lessee has to recognize a ROU asset, that is a right of use asset, and a lease liability. This means that under Ind AS 116, the lessee always had to deal with every lease transaction as a finance lease, and the option of operating lease was removed from lessee's point of view. Mind you that I'm not saying that lessee's point of view was changed. So from lessee's point of view, the lessee now has to recognize every lease as finance lease, and this means that the finance that the off balance sheet financing arrangement will now not be hidden from the financial statements. So this was the main objective, to reduce the off balance sheet financing and to increase the disclosure from lessee's point of view. Now recognition exemptions. So basically recognition exemptions are for which lease transactions does the lessee not require to follow this Ind AS. So the lessee has the option to not follow Ind AS 116 for short term leases and for low value asset leases. So what is short term leases? As I have mentioned, that at the commencement date of the lease, the commencement date being the date when the asset is made available for use by the lessor to the lessee. So at the commencement date of the lease, if the lessee identifies that the lease term, which we'll cover later what is lease term, if the lease term does not exceed 12 months, then the lessee can classify the lease as short term leases. Now also the lease should not have any purchase option. Purchase option means that the lessor is granting the lessee an option to purchase the asset at the end of the lease. So if at the commencement date the lease term is not exceeding 12 months and there is no purchase option available to the lessee can classify the lease as a short term lease. Now if the lessee classifies it as a short term lease, he or she can avail the exemption to not recognize such a lease under Ind AS 116. And the second exemption for recognition will be the low value asset leases. The low value asset leases here means that the lessee has to check whether the value of the asset when the lessee is taking the asset on lease, that is for the new asset, if the value is low, that is not significantly high, the lessee can avail the exemption that it is a low value asset lease. And in that case, the lessee need not follow Ind AS 116 recognition requirements. So in general, the example we used to cover was like, for the example, lessee is taking laptops on lease. So in that case, the value of laptops will be merely 30, 50,000, 70,000. So it is a low value lease, low value asset lease. So in that case, lessee can avail the exemption. We have to check it for new asset, and completely we have to see whether the asset is of low value or not. Also, I've written here that the low value asset leases, this exemption is not available to the head lease of intermediate lessor. So this will be covered separately, the intermediate lessor topic, but I'll explain it here. For example, I am giving asset on lease to you and you are giving it to someone else. So there are two lease transactions, one between you and me and the second between you and the third person. So the lease transaction between you and me is called the head lease, and you act as a immediate lessee to me, and for the third party you are an intermediate lessor. So basically you are acting as a lessee as well as a lessor, so you are called an intermediate lessor. I am the head lessor and the third party is the ultimate lessee. So for the intermediate lessor, that is for you, you cannot avail the low value asset lease exemption in the head lease. In the sub lease, which is between you and the third party, you may avail the exemption, but in the head lease you cannot avail the low value asset lease exemption. Clear? Now second, we'll move on to what is a lease. So what is a lease? Basically is the definition of lease. So I have classified it into divided it into various points. So firstly, we have to check it at the inception date. So inception date is the earlier of the lease agreement date and the date of commitment by both of the parties to the terms and conditions of the lease. So earlier of the lease agreement date and or the date of commitment by the parties to the terms and conditions is called the inception date. So at the inception date, what happens is the parties see whether there is the contract, whether the contract is a lease or whether the contract contains a lease. So whether contract is a lease is explainable in itself, but whether contract contains a lease, so I'll explain that. So any contract contains a lease when it satisfies these conditions, that is when it has these elements present in the contract. So if the contract has an identified asset, which I'll cover in the next slide, if the contract has an identified asset and the customer has the right to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits, and the customer has the right to direct how and for what purpose asset is used, or if the customer operates the asset, or if the customer has designed the asset. You have to memorize this. There should be identified asset for which we are talking about, which is in consideration. Now, if I am the lessor and you are the customer, you are the lessee, so I have to transfer all the rights to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits. Basically, I have to transfer the control of the asset to you, only then I can say that the contract contains a lease. So if I transfer the control to you, if you direct how and for what purpose the asset is used, if you have operated the asset, or if you are designing the asset, so these things will give an indication that I have transferred the control to you, or that you control the asset. So if there is an identified asset and you control the asset, then it can be said that the contract contains a lease. So at the inception date, we have to identify whether the contract is a lease or contract contains a lease. Now, elements of a lease contract, as I said, identified asset. So there should be an identified asset, there should be a right to control. Both of these we'll discuss in detail. Now, there should be a period of time, that is, a specified time period should be there for the lease. For example, it is a 5-year lease, 10-year lease, and there should be some consideration involved. So consideration should be specified at the inception of the contract itself. Now, we'll discuss both of these topics, identified asset and right to control. So 2.1 being identified asset. So as I said that there should be an identified asset, so to constitute a lease agreement, to constitute a lease contract. So what is identified asset? Basically, identified asset should be physically distinct. For example, if I'm giving you a laptop on lease, the laptop should be physically distinct. I should be able to identify that this laptop I am going to give you on lease. So it should be physically distinct first. Secondly, it should be explicit or implicitly specified asset. Example I have written, so explicitly, as I said, if the laptop is present with me, I have the laptop and we are talking about it, that I will give you the laptop on lease. So it is an explicitly specified asset that this laptop of this particular model which I own, I'll give you on lease. And now, on the other hand, implicitly specified asset means, for example, if I have not made the laptop, I do not have the laptop, but we are agreeing that I'll make the laptop as per your specifications and give you on lease. So that is an implicitly specified asset, whereby I do not have the asset. The asset is not specified explicitly, it is implicitly specified. So it can be either explicit or implicitly specified, but it should be a specified asset which should be physically distinct from other assets. Now, physically distinct may also mean that if I am giving you a building on lease, so the building should be physically distinct from other buildings. So that is a basic example. Now, the supplier should not have a substantive right to substitute asset at inception date. If I am the supplier and I am giving you the laptop on lease, I should not have a right to replace the asset, to substitute the asset at the inception of the lease. That is, at the inception date, I should not have a substantive right to substitute. Now, substantive right to substitute will have two conditions basically. That is, if I am the supplier and you are the lessee, you are the customer, I should not have the practical ability to substitute the asset, and I should not benefit economically from substituting the asset. So practical ability means that if you are not able to prevent me from substituting the asset, it means that I have the practical ability. And if my benefits exceed cost, it means I have been benefiting economically. So both of these should not be present. So to sum it up all, I should not have a substantive right to substitute the asset at the inception date means that I should not have a practical ability, that is, you should be able to prevent me from substituting the asset first, and second, I should not benefit economically, that is, my benefit from substituting should not exceed the cost of substituting. Only in that case I can say that I do not have a substantive right to substitute, and in that case we'll conclude that there is a identified asset in the contract involved. Now, right to control. So right to control is important, because if there is no right to control transferred from my side to yours, that is, from the lessor side to the lessee, it cannot be termed as a lease agreement, as a lease contract. So what is right to control? So right to control, firstly, it should be present throughout the period of use. If you are having the right to control for, let's say, 1 year out of a 2-year lease contract, So you will have the lease for only 1 year, and the second 1 year shall be treated differently under a different standard. So we have to identify that the right to control should exist throughout the period for which we are saying that it is a lease contract. First thing. Now, second thing, right to control is right is said to be of right of control when the customer, that is you, should have both of these things present. Firstly, is that you should be having a right to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits of the IA, IA being the identified asset. You should have substantially all of the economic benefits, and secondly, you should have the right to direct the use of the identified asset. You should have the right to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits, and you should have the right to obtain right to direct the use of the identified asset. So now, what do these things mean? So the right to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits means that you should have the right to obtain the benefits which will be generated from the identified asset's primary output, that is the good or service itself, that is in our case the laptop. Now the byproducts, so we did an example in the main video on the renewable energy credit, so that is being covered here, and any commercial transaction with a third party. For example, if I am giving you the laptop on lease, and now you can obtain the economic benefits of the laptop by giving it to lease to a third person, so that is by subleasing the laptop. So you should have the economic benefits either through the primary outputs or the byproducts or through commercial transaction with third parties. So this means that you have the right to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits of the identified asset. Now, secondly, you should have the right to direct the use of the identified asset. It means that you should have the right to direct how and for what purpose the identified asset will be used, where and when it will be used, and you should have the right to operate it or design it. So some of these points we covered earlier when we were defining the identified asset. So basically, you should have a right to direct the use of the asset, that is how, when, where, for what purpose the asset will be used, and you should be able to obtain substantially all of the economic benefits. In that case, I can say that I have transferred the right of control to you. And if the right of control to you is transferred, and the right of control should be for an identified asset with a specific time period and for a specified consideration, four conditions. If these four conditions are met, we can say that it is a lease agreement. Clear? Now, next, the supplier's protective rights not to be considered if it does not affect the scope of the customer's use of asset. For example, if I'm giving you a car on lease, okay, and let's say we agreed that you'll not drive the car for more than 1,000 kilometer. So the 1,000 kilometer is not restricting your right to use the car for up to 1,000 kilometer. That is my protective right that you should not use the car for more than 1,000 kilometer. So that protective right does not infringe your right to enjoy the asset for up to 1,000 kilometer. That means for up to 1,000 kilometer, it can be easily said that you have the right to control the asset for up to 1,000 kilometer, because my protective right for you not using the asset for more than 1,000 kilometer does not affect your right to enjoy the asset, to obtain the benefits of asset, to direct the use of asset for up to 1,000 kilometer. So that is what this line means. So this is all on right to control. Now we'll move on to a separate topic, although I think it should have been discussed later, but I'm going with the flow of ICI. So separation of components. So I've written it separation of components. There can be two types of separation of components. Let's think. First can be like in an agreement, in a contract, we have more than one lease component. So there might be multiple lease components, and we have to think whether we should separate each lease component separately. Or there can be another instance where we have one lease component and one non-lease component in a single contract. So in that case, we have to think whether we have to separate the lease component and the non-lease component. So two types of separation we are talking about. One is between lease components, and one is between lease and non-lease component. So firstly, I'm coming to the lease components part. So Ind AS 116 says that there should be the presence of two conditions, both of these conditions. Only when both of these conditions are satisfied, this is all from the lessee point of view, only when both of these conditions are satisfied, a lessee can separate the lease components. So the lessee should separate the lease components only when the lessee can benefit from the use of identified asset either on its own together with other resources readily available to the lessee. And secondly, the underlying asset is neither highly dependent nor highly interrelated with other assets in the contract. Now, for those of you who have done Ind AS 115, you will recognize that this definition is basically that of a distinct asset. So what this point basically means that if in a contract we have multiple lease components meaning like one is for laptop, one is for phone, and multiple we have identified assets. So for each identified asset, if we can identify that each of the identified asset is basically a distinct identified asset. Distinct here meaning that you as a lessee can enjoy the asset either on its own or with any other resources which are available to you, and one of those assets is not highly dependent or highly interrelated with the other asset in the contract. For example, if the laptop and mobile we are taking into consideration, the use of laptop will not be dependent or interrelated on the use of mobile. So in that case, we can say that you can classify the laptop component as a separate lease component and the phone component as a separate lease component. So that was one point. Now, secondly, I've written a thing that contract equals to lease agreement plus purchase sale agreement. This is basically the lease component and the non-lease component part. So this was one point where we were separating lease components only. Now this is where we are separating lease from non-lease component. So lease agreement is the thing which we discussed till now. It will be covered under Ind AS 116. Now sometimes there might be a purchase and sale agreement along with it, which will be covered under Ind AS 115, that is revenue from contracts with customers. So for a basic example, if I'm giving you a building on rent, on lease, and apart from that, I'm also giving you maintenance services for the building. So the building will come under lease agreement, but the maintenance services will not come under the Ind AS 116 scope. So that will be classified under Ind AS 115, that is revenue from contract with customers. So you see that basically there are two components here. Now lessee has to think whether or not he should separate both of these components, and the condition for that is he should, in general, he should always distinguish both of these components and treat them under the respective Ind AS's. But Ind AS 116 also provides a practical expedient whereby the lessee may not be required to separate the lease component from the non-lease component. The reason here being is that it would involve too much of accounting and it would be practically not possible for the lessee. For example, if a lessee enters into lots of lease agreements, so to classify each lease agreement and separate each lease and non-lease agreement would be too much work. So that is why Ind AS 116 is providing a practical expedient not to separate both of these components. So the practical expedient says that the expedient is available firstly only to the lessee, that we know. Now the second thing it says, basically the practical expedient means that the lessee will not separately classify the lease and non-lease component. If the lessee has used the practical expedient, that is he is not separating both the components, that then he can allocate the total consideration to the lease agreement itself. But if he is not using the practical expedient, that is he is separating the lease and non-lease component, in that case 116 says that you have to allocate the consideration to the lease component and to the non-lease component based on their respective relative standalone price. Standalone price is basically covered in detail in Ind AS 115, that is the SSP I said there. That is the standalone selling price. So basically the lease component and the non-lease component, we have to identify what is the standalone price of both of these components and then allocate the total consideration in the ratio of the relative standalone prices. Now standalone prices, if it is observable, that is if we can say that what price the customer will pay for the lease component, for the non-lease component, then we'll use the observable standalone price. And if we do not have the observable standalone price, then we'll take the estimated standalone price. So this is all on separation of components. Now contract combination. In the earlier slide, what we did was we were separating components, lease from lease component, lease from non-lease component. Now this point speaks about combination of contracts. So under contract combination, basically Ind AS 116 requires you to combine two or more contracts if they are satisfying three conditions basically. The first condition is that the contract should be entered at or near the same time. The second condition, it should be entered with the same counterparty or with a party related to the counterparty. And the third condition is that it should satisfy either of these three conditions. That is, if any of the these three are satisfied, the third condition will be satisfied. So we'll elaborate on the third condition. The third condition says that if the contract is negotiated as a package with the overall commercial objective, or if the consideration of any of the contract depends on the price or the performance of the other contracts, or if the contracts are negotiated as a single lease component, in that case, if either of these three conditions are satisfied and the contracts are entered into at or near the same time and with the same party or a party related to the counterparty, in that case, we can combine the contracts. Now, what is also to be noticed here that for these, I have covered examples in the main video, but due to lack of time, I'll not cover it here. Now, we'll move on to the next topic, that is the key concepts. So this is the third point of the ICI SM2. So in the key concept, it says that what is a lease term. So basically a lease term will include three terms. First will be the non-cancellable period, which I'll discuss after this. Now second will be the period which the lessee is reasonably certain to exercise an option to extend the period. And the third is the period which the lessee is reasonably certain to not exercise the option to terminate the period. That is basically the non-cancellable period plus the period which the lessee will extend plus the period which the lessee will not terminate. So these three periods will form the lease term, and the lease term is to be counted from the commencement date and not the inception date. Now, importance of lease term was which we covered in the beginning of this video. And that is basically the short term leases. For example, if the lease term is up to 12 months, we'll classify it as a short term leases and we can avail the recognition exemption. And if it is more than 12 months, then we cannot classify it as a short term lease and therefore we cannot avail the recognition exemption of 1 month 6. Now we'll move on to the non-cancellable period. So for non-cancellable period, we have to understand what is a cancellable period. So cancellable lease basically means we have to check the enforceability. So agreement, if it is not enforceable, then it will mean that it is cancellable. And if it is enforceable, then it will mean that it is not cancellable. So enforceability basically means that agreement is not enforceable if both lessor and lessee have the right to terminate lease without others' permission. So if I can terminate the lease agreement without your permission, and also on termination, I do not have to pay any significant penalty. That means that the agreement is not enforceable. See, if I had to pay a significant penalty, or if I had to avail your permission to cancel the lease, in that case, it would be termed as an enforceable lease. But in this case, if I do not have to take your permission and I do not have to pay any significant penalty, it means that the agreement is not enforceable. And if it is not enforceable, it means it is a cancellable period. So that is basically we have to see for the non-cancellable period, that the non-cancellable period of a lease will be that period in which the lease is enforceable contract. Now, change in lease term. So the lease term which we just now covered, there might be a change in the lease term due to any change in significant events or circumstances. So such events and circumstances will be accounted for as a change in lease term only if such events and circumstances are within the lessee's control and it affects lessee's reasonably certainty. It affects lessee's reasonable certainty to exercise or not exercise option. That means it affects these two boxes, or it has not been previously included in the lease term determination. So if any significant event or circumstances takes place whereby the event or circumstances is within the lessee's control and it affects lessee's reasonable certainty to either extend the contract or to terminate the contract, and also that is to exercise the option or to not to exercise the option, and also such an option was not previously accounted for when we were assessing the lease term, so in that case there might arise a condition whereby the lessee has to change the lease term. Now, lease term is also important for the calculation of the finance lease, whereby we see whether the lease term covers significantly the life of the identified asset which we are giving on lease. So that is why lease term is a pretty important point in a lease agreement. Now we'll cover more key concepts. So now next is the lease payment. So lease payment is what payment you will be giving to me, you being the lessee. So if I have given you the asset on lease, so you will give me some payment, some consideration. So that consideration here is the lease payment, and I have divided into points. So lease term is basically the sum of 6 points. So first point will be the fixed payments. So you will make me some fixed payments. The fixed payments means payments other than variable payments. Basically, variable payments here does not mean the variable payment we think in costing. It means any payment which is dependent upon a condition or occurrence of an event. So the fixed payment here means a payment which is not dependent on any occurrence of any event or condition. So first is the fixed payment. Now second is in substance fixed payment. So in substance fixed payment is a payment which is variable, but it is unavoidable. The variable lease payment here may be avoidable, but the in substance fixed payment is variable plus unavoidable. Then variable lease payment. So variable lease payment, there can be two types of variable lease payment. First is a variable lease payment which is dependent upon an index or rate, and second which is not dependent upon index or rate. So the variable lease payment which is dependent upon index or rate, that is index being like consumer price index or rate being the labor. So in such cases, the variable lease payment will be included in the lease payment. And if it is not dependent on the index or rate, then it will be directly transferred to PL as an expense for you and as an income for me. Okay. Now, fifth element will be exercise price of a purchase option. So, exercise price of a purchase option means we have to see whether the lessee, that is you, if you are reasonably certain to exercise the purchase option, then the exercise price of that purchase option you will have to pay to me, and therefore it is included in the calculation of lease payment. So, for termination penalties, it is similar to exercise price of purchase option. So, if there is no reasonable certainty that you will not terminate the lease, that is, we can say that there is no reasonable certainty that you will not terminate may sometimes equal to that there is a reasonable certainty that you will terminate the lease. So, in that case, what we can do is we will include the termination penalties in the calculation of lease payment. Although we have to, in exams, we should write it like this only, and we should not write that there is a reasonable certainty that lessee will terminate, because both of them have different meanings. So, if there is no reasonable certainty that you being the lessee will not terminate the agreement, in that case, the termination penalties will also form a part of lease payments. Now, these five were additions to the calculation of lease payment, but this is a subtraction from the lease payment, and it basically is the lease incentive. So, when we add all the five payments, we'll deduct the lease incentive, because the five payments were being made by you to me, but the lease incentive will be given by me to you. So, lease incentive basically means any reimbursement of any cost you had incurred, or any assumption of cost, that is any cost which you had to incur, I am incurring in your place. So, any such lease incentive shall be reduced from the lease payment. And now, these six components altogether will form our lease payment. Now, lease payments will also include a sixth component, which is the residual value guarantees. Now, the residual value guarantee, these five payments would be common for both of us. So, your calculation of lease payment and my calculation of lease payment would include these five same. But for residual value guarantees, which I call GRVs, that is guaranteed residual values. So, for residual value guarantees, for lessee it will be different, and for lesser it will be different. So, for lessee, that is you, any amount which you have guaranteed to the lesser, that is me, or any party unrelated to me, in that case, you will include that amount in your calculation of lease payments as a GRV, that is a residual value guarantee. But for me, I'll include only those amounts which have been guaranteed to me by you, or by any party related to you, or by any party unrelated to me. So, this is a basic distinction whereby any party, which parties are being considered for the residual value guarantees, have to be taken into account for a lessee and for a lesser. So, the lease payments now include six components altogether. Now, after that, we will cover initial direct cost, that is IDC. So, IDC for a manufacturer and dealer will be treated differently, and for the lesser who is other than manufacturer and dealer, it will be covered differently. So, what is initial direct cost? So, I can explain it in such a way that if you and I were to arrive at a common place to sign an agreement, and what were those costs which would be avoidable if we both did not sign the agreement? That is basically the initial direct cost. Initial direct cost is nothing but that cost which is incurred for the making the agreement possible, for making the lesser and lessee get into an agreement. And such a cost would be avoidable if you and I were not to enter into a contract. So, initial direct cost for other than manufacturer and dealer, I have included the ICI table. So, for example, the commission would not be paid if you and I were not to enter into a contract, but it would be paid if we entered into a contract. So, similarly, you can see all these will be included and all these will be excluded. For example, employee salaries will have to be paid irrespective of whether you and I enter into an agreement. So, that is the basic idea of this. But for IDC about manufacturer or dealer, so manufacturer or dealer, for them, this is the basic business of theirs, and lease is not a separate thing for them. So, a manufacturer or dealer will not consider IDC separately. It is a regular expense for a manufacturer dealer, and he or she will therefore transfer it to PL as an expense. Now, next will be the key discount rate. So, for a lessee, discount rate will be the interest rate implicit, and if interest rate implicit is unavailable, then it will be the incremental borrowing rate. But for a lesser, we'll always take the interest rate implicit. So, what is interest rate implicit? It can be arrived by through using this formula, whereby the present value of the lease payments, present value of the minimum lease payments, shall be equal to the fair value of the asset plus the initial direct cost minus the UGRV, that is the unguaranteed residual value. So, we have to arrive at a discount rate which will make the present value of the lease payments equal to the fair value of the asset plus initial direct cost minus the unguaranteed residual value. And incremental borrowing rate, if you are taking, then we have to see that the borrowing rate should be for such an instrument which has a similar term, similar security, similar value, and in a similar economic environment. For exam purposes, these rates shall be given in the question. And now we'll move on to fourth part, lease account, lessee accounting. So lessee accounting being the most important thing in this Ind AS 116, because that was the major changes the lessee's point of view. So I have not summarized that part because I do not think it should be summarized. So you have to watch the fourth video for this point. Now I'll move on to the lesser accounting. So lesser accounting at inception date, what the lessor will do is that he or she will classify whether it is a finance lease or an operating lease. That is, I have to classify at the inception date whether the lease agreement I have entered into is a finance lease or operating lease. See, the lessee does not have to do all this, because for the lessee it will always be a finance lease now, because you have to recognize the ROU asset and the lease liability. So for at the inception date, I'm seeing whether the risk and reward related to the agreement have been transferred to you or not. If I have transferred the risk and reward, then it is a finance lease. But if I have not transferred the risk and reward, that is, if I have retained the risk and reward, then it is an operating lease. And what is a risk and reward? We'll cover it in the next slide. Also, I have some other concepts here. So for a lessee, for a lessor, if a lessor is entering into a finance lease, then he has to recognize in his books gross investment, net investment, and all those things. So what is gross investment? Gross investment is basically whatever the lease payments are receivable by me under the finance lease plus UGRV. So in lease payments calculation, I covered the sixth point, whereby I told that GRV shall be included. GRV means the residual value guaranteed. So lease payments include the GRV, but for gross investment we have to also include the unguaranteed residual value separately. Now you might be wondering, what are unguaranteed residual value? So unguaranteed residual value are nothing but the part of the residual value which is not assured or guaranteed by a party related to the lessor. So this is what forms our gross investment. Now when we bring the gross investment to the present value by using the discount rates which we covered earlier, then we arrive at the net investment. So because we are dealing from a lesser perspective, lesser's perspective, so therefore the discount rate used here will be the interest rate implicit for the lesser, and by discounting the gross investment we'll arrive at our net investment, which has to be shown as an asset under the finance lease, which we'll cover for the lesser. Now I have discussed that we'll cover the conditions for finance lease. So these are the basic conditions. They are not too heavy, so you can discuss, you can read them. So I'll cover one or two points. For example, if the ownership of the asset is transferred at the end of the lease term, then it can be classified as a finance lease. Now similarly, all the points have been covered and they are very easy. I'll jump on to this part. So for if the agreement is cancelled, for example, and the loss on cancellation, if the lessee can cancel the lease, the lessor's losses associated with the cancellation are borne by lessee, then it can be termed as a finance lease, because it means that the loss on cancellation, the risk of loss on cancellation has been transferred to the lessee. Similarly, there is an option to extend the lease. So if you are a lessee and you have the ability to extend the lease price at a rent which is substantially lower than the market rent, that means that you have an option to extend the lease at a price lower than the market. Therefore, it means that it is a finance lease. Also, these conditions are not very explicit, so these are basically indicators, and one has to apply professional judgment to see whether it is a finance lease or an operating lease. You can read the conditions. Then land and building lease classification. So land and building lease classification is a separate topic, just because there is a small issue here that land has an indefinite economic life. Now what is the issue is that for a building, let's say we can say that the building has a 40-year life, and for example I give it to you on a lease for a 37-year. So that means I've given it to you, given the asset to you on lease for a substantial economic life of the asset. Therefore it will be classified as a finance lease. But for a land, you cannot have the economic life of the land. You cannot determine it. It is indefinite. So that means that it will always put the land into an operating lease condition from lessor's point of view. Now this being the issue, that if I have given to you a building on lease, I'll also give the land opportunity to the building to you. Now if the land and building are given to you on lease together, so there is a issue that we have to classify, we have to separate the land and building, because land will come under operating lease and the building may come under operating or finance lease. So if we are separating both of these components, then we have to allocate the lease payments too. Now for the total consideration which you will pay me, I'll allocate the lease payments to the land part and to the building part separately based on the fair value of the leasehold interest at the inception date. So the fair value of leasehold interest will be given to you in the question, and you have to allocate the lease payments based on that amount. Now, if classification is clear, clear means I can classify that land is operating and building is finance. So I'll treat it accordingly. I know how to treat operating leases and I know how to treat finance leases. But if it is unclear, then Ind AS 116 says that you have to take the entire agreement as a finance lease. Therefore, the land as well as the building will be treated as a finance lease unless and until it is clear that both of them are either operating leases. So if it is clear that both of them are operating, then we'll take it as operating. But if it is unclear, then we'll take both of them as a finance lease. So in that case, what will happen if the land element is, for example, let's say it is immaterial. So if the land element is immaterial, then Ind AS 116 says that you have to treat it as a single unit. That is, both land and building will be treated as a single unit, and we'll take the economic life of the building to be the economic life of the entire underlying asset and do the treatments accordingly. So this was the basic point whereby this was the main issue, that land has an indefinite economic life. Now we'll move on to the treatment of finance lease, and then we'll move on to the treatment of operating lease in the books of the lessor. So for finance lease, I've made this small chart. This is basically RNM, means recognition and measurement. So how the lessor will recognize and measure the finance lease in his books. So first will be the recognition, that is how he will initially recognize the asset, the lease agreement, and then we'll do the subsequent measurement. So initial recognition means at the commencement date what he or she will do, and subsequent measurement means at the subsequent balance sheet date what he or she will do. So under initial recognition also I have bifurcated it into two parts. First will be what will happen for other than manufacturer dealer, and the second will be what will happen for manufacturer and dealer. So initial recognition for other than manufacturer and dealer, what the lessor will do. So under a finance lease, the lessor will de-recognize the assets. For example, I'm giving you the building on lease, so I'll de-recognize the building from my book and I'll recognize a net investment in lease in my books. Net investment we just now covered, it is basically the present value of gross investment, and gross investment is nothing but the lease payments under the finance lease plus the unguaranteed residual value. Now, having de-recognized one asset and recognized an asset, I'll recognize the selling profit and loss. It is nothing but the difference in these two amounts. Also, the initial direct cost which are incurred by other than manufacturer dealer, we had covered it earlier that it will be considered for net investment as compared to manufacturer dealer, where I told you that it will be treated as an expense and transferred to PL. So in the books of manufacturer and dealer, in case of initial recognition, see, the manufacturer and dealer has this as its business and it is not a separate thing for him. So any lease agreement entered into by manufacturer or dealer will be treated basically as a sale agreement. So that is why I have written here that whatever there will be recognition in the books of manufacturer or dealer will be one revenue, second is cost, and third is the profit and loss. So it is basically the PL, the trading profit and loss, we can say. So the revenue will be nothing but the lower of the fair value of the asset or present value of the lease payments. So in a finance lease, what the manufacturer or dealer will do is he'll recognize the finance fair value of the asset, then he'll identify what is the present value of the lease payment. So he'll get to the present value by using the interest rate implicit. Now the lower of both of these amounts shall be recognized as a revenue in his books. Now similarly, he'll recognize the cost of the asset as a cost of sale. So the cost of sale will be nothing but the carrying amount of the asset in his books. So in my case, what is the carrying amount of the building in my books? I subtract the unguaranteed residual values, present value from it. That will be my cost of sale. So I got the revenue, I got the cost of sale, and now I'll recognize it as a selling profit and loss. The difference will be basically the selling profit and loss, which will be covered under Ind AS 115 and not 116. So it is basically a case of revenue from contracts with customers and not a case of leases. And IDC, I already told you, it will be treated as an expense. So this covers the initial recognition. Now at subsequent measurement, that is at subsequent balance sheet dates, what will happen is, now see here, what we had in our books was a net investment in lease, and what we had was a lease liability. We'll have two components here. So for the net investment in lease and lease liability in our books, what we'll do now is, firstly, we'll recognize the finance income as per the interest rate implicit. So how the finance income is determined is, whatever the net investment we have, we'll apply the interest rate implicit on the net investment. That means, like, if I have a 100 rupees net investment and there is a 10% interest rate implicit, that means for every year I'm getting a 10 rupees finance income from you, you being the lessee, I being the lessor. So every year I'll recognize 10 rupees as a finance income and I'll pass the entry net investment in lease debit to finance income, thereby increasing my net investment and showing 10 rupees as a finance income in my profit and loss. Second, what I'll do is whatever the actual lease payment you'll pay me, I'll record that in my books. So I'll record an entry bank account debit to net investment. So I'll reduce my net investment and also I'll receive the lease payment. So that will be the second entry. Now, thirdly, what I'll do is variable lease payment. See if they were based on the usage and performance. So I earlier told you that I'll recognize it as an income and you'll recognize it as an expense. And lastly, whatever net investment is there at the year end, I'll check it for impairment as per Ind AS 36. So this covers the finance lease. Now I'll come to the operating lease. It is a very small portion. So operating lease is basically, it says that you take the total operating lease and you can like divide it on the basis of number of years of lease or any other systematic basis. So we have to arrive at a systematic basis, say it may be a straight line method or any other basis, and we recognize lease income based on that method. Also, the initial direct cost will be recognized on the same basis as the lease income. Lastly, it says that the variable lease payments, which are usage or performance based, that is, which are not based on the index or rate, will be recognized as income as and when they are earned. Having said that, now I'm coming to the last point of the lessor, that is the presentation of the lease in his books. So if it is a finance lease, the lessor will present a receivable in his books at an amount equal to the net investment. Also, apart from net investment, he'll also distinguish the net investment as a current or non-current, because some part of the net investment will be receivable within 12 months and some after 12 months. So current and non-current bifurcation will hold good there. But for operating leases, it is different. For operating leases, because I'm not derecognizing the asset, so I have the asset in my books. So basically what I'll do is the lessor is required to present the underlying asset according to the nature of that asset in the balance sheet under Ind AS 116. So I have the asset in my books and I'll recognize the income at the year end every year. So there is not much to do in operating leases. A bit of complication is there in the finance leases only. So till now what we have covered is overview first. And then second, what is a lease? Third, what is overview of lease? And fifth, the lesser treatment. All these four have around 1 1-hour videos. That means we have covered around 4 hours stuff in this revision video. Now two parts are remaining. That is the part four, which is the lessee treatment, for which I'll not be making a summarized video because it is the essence of this Ind AS. So to summarize it would not justify the Ind AS. So you have to watch the full video for that. And the sixth part, which is the other matters, which includes the sublease and sale and lease back. So I am planning to make a separate video, summarize short video for it, but I do not guarantee it. It is also an important issue. And with that, I'm ending this video, and do hit the like button, because YouTube promotes content if it is more liked by the viewers. So do hit the like button, and I'm ending the video.